Hello there. Now that we're into December, for many of us, it's time to wind down for the festive period. The same, however, cannot be said for clubs in the Football League as they prepare for one of the busiest times in the football calendar, one which could make or break a season. Well, Steve's with me to reflect on what's been a day full of surprising results. And if you're at one of those games, Lizzie would love to hear from you. Lizzie.
Yeah, the good, the bad and the ugly. If you were at a game today, we want to hear your footballing story. Text us on 81111 or send us an email to footballleague@bbc.co.uk. Put your thinking caps on and come up with some cracking questions for Steve as well. And remember, leave your name and put your club in the subject bar.
Thanks, Lizzie. Here's what's on tonight's Football League show. The last time Middlesbrough won, Gareth Southgate was in charge and they were a point behind the leaders in fourth. Now under Gordon Strachan, Borough without a win in four and down to 10th. Today they met a QPR side enjoying their best run in years. Two other sides going really well are local rivals Nottingham Forest and Leicester City. They met at the City Ground as fourth played third.
But the team going better than any of them is Leeds. Today the runaway League One leaders were up against fellow promotion chasers Huddersfield, a feisty Yorkshire derby in front of 38,000 people.
Well, we'll have the Forest-Leicester game coming up shortly, but first to Loftus Road then, where QPR enjoying their best start to a league season in 5 years. They have, however, found it tough going in recent weeks, as have Middlesbrough, who are looking for their first win under Gordon Strachan. But just like his previous jobs at Coventry and Southampton, could he get his first league win at the fifth attempt? Coventry comes from Dan O'Hagan.
Two clubs itching for a Premier League return. It's almost 14 years since Queen's Park Rangers relegation. They're proof of just how hard getting back can be. Middlesbrough's first season since demotion has been a turbulent one. Gordon Strachan seeking a first win as their manager in this, his fifth game in charge. The Hoops handily placed among the playoff chasers, though too many draws has been their Achilles heel. The defence welcomes back Kaspers Gorksh, with the midfield full of creativity. Buzaki Terapton, Wayne Routledge play behind eight-goal Jay Simpson on loan from Arsenal. Borough have been stronger away from home this season. Gary O'Neill returns from injury, Rhys Williams from suspension in place of Adam Johnson and Tony McMahon. The on-loan Isaiah Osborne and Dave Kitson retain their places. Kitson scored twice at Peterborough last week. There's an A-list director's box these days at Loftus Road. This is Bhasin and Briatore. This is Leroy Lita and Mark Yates. Yates gets the cross in towards Kitson. Defender here is Ledgerwood. Routledge. Here goes Terapt again for QPR. Terapt still goes for goal himself when he had two in the middle. Better place than he. Well, he can be sometimes a soloist and a touch frustrating, Adel Terapt. And here he had two teammates in the centre, but chose to take on the shot himself. Lita made the run and gets the pass. In the middle, he's got Dave Kitson. This is Leroy Lita. It's Lita still. Leroy Lita into the midriff of Radek Cerny. Borough's first attempt on goal comes, what, a quarter hour in? But Cerny more than equal to it. Well, home has been sweet home for QPR this season. Just one defeat in the league here to Leicester. The home form has been their trump card under Jim McGilton so far. Borrowdale. Adel Terapt comes off Rhys Williams and St. Ledger with a clever ball to find Mark Yates here. It's Mark Yates! Oh, what a hit off the crossbar! Kitson's in there, but Cheney has it. But Mark Yates was so close to his first Borough goal. And against the frame of the QPR goal, and Yates, with Borough's best attempt so far, had Cerny well beaten, but not the crossbar. Glorious hit from Mark Yates here. Ledgerwood. That's Pogatetz away. This is Yates. Away from Watson, whose boot was high. Yates still. Yates looking for Lita. Yates caught late by Fitz Hall. Well, Yates here was making real inroads into that QPR defence, and he was chopped down by Fitz Hall. And the game's first yellow card coming here for Fitzhall as well. O'Neill's free kick swung in. Kitson! Dave Kitson! His third goal on loan for Middlesbrough. And they have the breakthrough goal. Against Rangers, the lone Ranger for Borough gets the away team in front. O'Neill's delivery was super smooth here, and the finish not too shabby either. Dave Kitson, three goals now in his Borough loan spell. O'Neill here with a lovely delivery, and Dave Kitson steals in to score. Togatets, Yates, O'Neill again, Archer. Here's Dave Kitson. Littlewood nips in there for Queen's Park Rangers. Well, his goal the difference so far. QPR, after a good start, trailed by 1-0. Dave Kitson's third goal in a week, 2 at Peterborough last weekend. In a 2-2 draw. Here's Kitson again to tee up Gary O'Neill. O'Neill will try and curl, and it's Cherney save this time. O'Neill denied by a fine save from Redick Cherney. O'Neill's made 1 so far and could have had 2 himself. This is a lovely effort, bending and swerving, and that's a fine save as well. This is Akos Buzaki, Wheater clear. Walker and then O'Neill away for Borough. It would slip, it could be costly, Lita. And Yates breaks away. QPR's captain fell, here's Yates. Littlewood, who recovered, has put the ball behind for a corner. O'Neill's corner for Middlesbrough. In by O'Neill, towards Wheater, and some legend, Wheater! Whistle's gone. He's given a penalty, I think. Handball, says the referee. And though Borough found the net, they have to now try again from the spot. O'Neill's corner comes in. Wheater and St. Ledger challenge for it. And here, the hand of Ben Watson. Wheater scores, but it doesn't count. Leroy Lita against Radek Cherney for a 2-goal Middlesbrough lead. It's Leroy Lita scores emphatically. Leroy Lita with the perfect conversion. And it's a 2-goal Borough lead now. And the two from the Reading players have got Borough 2 clear. Leroy Lita's caution for inciting the crowd too. Well, Rowan Vine comes on for QPR in place of Jay Simpson. So on is Patrick Aguimang as well. Double striking change for Queen's Park Rangers. Vine and Aguimang on as the manager rings the attacking changes. Kitson. This is Tarabt. Borrowdale towards Aguimang. Tarabt, here's Rowan Vine, first touch onside. Rowan Vine across to Aguimang! His first touch, Rangers right back in the game. Well, there are changes, and there are changes. Within seconds of the double substitution, the two combine, and QPR score. The first up here, Rowan Vine finds the second, and Patrick Aguimang makes it 2-1. Lovely goal for QPR. Rowan Vine's cross, Aguimang's finish, game on again. Ben Watson now for Wayne Routledge. Legend would give it away to Yates, could be costly this because Lita spins away. Leroy Lita. Lita still, lovely run, deflected shot, 3-1 Middlesbrough. Leroy Lita's second restores Borough's 2-goal advantage. Leroy Lita up against Fitzhall. Off the post, in for 3-1 Borough. Leroy Lita Mita with a Middlesbrough double. And they now have a 3-1 lead here. His second of the day. Comes off the studs of Fitzhall. And in. And Ben Watson. This is Wayne Routledge again for QPR. Routledge, tricky player, lively into Agumang here. He goes down under Pogatetsu's challenge. Play goes on with Routledge here. Deflected cross. Agumang again. Another penalty claim there for QPR this time. Agumang went down under Pogatetsu's challenge. Another maybe here. Another should have been perhaps. Here's Osborne now for O'Neill and Borough in business now through Leroy Lita. Lita in the middle, O'Neill. It's Leroy Lita driving on, hits the post, O'Neill! And that's a fourth Borough goal, and the captain has his name on the score sheet, and Borough now are on their way to their first ever win at Queen's Park Rangers. 4-1 now. Leroy Lita against the post, and Gary O'Neill on the score sheet. Jim McGilton's team are being well beaten here. 4-1 behind. Jones to Pogatetsu. Tarantis with him. This is Yates. Yates for Kitson. Took it neatly. Here's Lita, who holds his run, but Yates will chase it through. It's Mark Yates. It's a lovely run! It's a fabulous goal! Mark Yates, first for Borough, is a beauty! Mark Yates with a gem, a beauty, a stunner, a cracker, whichever you like, it's one of those. Lovely goal! QPR 1, Middlesbrough 5. Look at that! Where's that result come from for Borough?
It's a great result for us to come to QPR and, you know, win 5-1 is a big result. We know how tough it is going to be, and we made it fairly easy for ourselves in the end.
We started quite well. I mean, we had our shape. We frustrated them a bit, and we managed to take our chances today, which is we haven't managed to do in the last few weeks. So we felt that result had been coming, really. We've been creating chances on the road, and nice to put some away today.
We've handed out a few Haydens this year, so it's hard to take, you're at home, but we were well beaten today by a very good side.
Yeah, they were indeed. I mean, Gordon Strachan will certainly be a happier man tonight. His bugbear was putting the ball in the back of the net, but you can't ask more, can you, for 8 attempts on goal and scoring 5 of them.
Yes, if you're going to break that that winless run, better to do it and score 5 goals into the bargain. He's made a huge difference, Dave Kitson. Proven at this level.
Yeah.
You know, gone through the division with Reading, yeah. I mean, huge amount of points, huge amount of goals. Lita, you know, he's had spells where he's been very, very good and a little bit off, out of sorts. He looks like he's coming back to his best. He's a real threat, as you see, a little bit of pace. Gary O'Neill, super player, was with him at Portsmouth. You know, really has got technically very, very good, as you can see there. And Mark Yates, who's coming for Adam Johnson. Mm. That's a fantastic goal. And they played very, very well today, especially on the break.
And they are very good away from home. They've scored so many goals.
Yeah.
But 3 wins in 9 at the Riverside. I suppose Gordon Strachan will now be saying, right, you've got to do this at home now.
Yeah, absolutely. I mean, you would imagine that the players that we're talking about here would be able to play under pressure, because that can be the only reason why they're not getting results away from home. They've won 5. Yet they've only won 3 at home, and that undoubtedly has been, you know, the thing that's caught them out so far.
And QPR looking vulnerable at the back, aren't they?
Yes, they conceded 2 the other day against Coventry, and I know he said that was like almost like a loss, drew that 1-2-1. And today, yeah, I mean, as you say, they were very, very good. There was a little bit of an imbalance, shall we say. There were probably too many people worried about going forward, and possibly not quite enough doing their job defensively today.
Right, well, that result meant QPR were likely to slip out of the playoff places. And there was another game involving 2 playoff contenders at the City Ground in the form of an East Midlands derby. It was 4th v. 3rd as Nottingham Forest took on Leicester City.
Two form teams eyeing the playoffs and an East Midlands derby to boot. Nottingham Forest versus Leicester might have had the makings of a close encounter. Forest went into the game knowing a win would lift them above their opponents and up to the dizzy heights of 3rd. The game was less than 12 minutes old when they took the lead, Rob Earnshaw making a rare start. If you're not used to the celebration, you soon will be. Forest midfielder Paul Anderson was born in Leicestershire and spent some time with the Foxes as a schoolboy. He couldn't get the better of Chris Whale on this occasion. The Forest pressure was relentless. Dexter Blackstock went close. Chris Cohen, back in his favoured midfield role, also tried his luck. And the ball fell to Earnshaw. There's no stopping the Welsh striker when he's in this mood. If that was an instinctive poacher's goal, there was plenty for Earnshaw to do when he picked up the ball near the halfway line, but he completed the task with style. And that's how it feels to score your first hat-trick in over 4.5 years. Leicester had drawn 2 and lost one of their Midlands matchups before this one, and this was looking like another derby day to forget when Anderson put Forest 4 up. What a strike it was too. Desperate to avoid total humiliation, the Foxes didn't give up. Richie Whelan's shot was blocked by Wes Morgan's hand, according to the referee. Penalty kick awarded. Martin Waghorn took it and converted emphatically. But it hardly dampened the day for the Forest faithful. Next, 2 of the subs got involved. Gareth McCleary making a great run, but Dele Adebola couldn't quite make the most of the perfect cross. Adebola did get another chance to add his name to the roll of honour, though. Whale could only parry McCleary's shot, and the Nigerian striker was on hand to add to Leicester's misery. 5-1, Forest now unbeaten in 11.
Well, I thought all over the pitch, I thought defensively very good and right through the side, and you know, you've seen today that we're a great goal threat.
Shocking day. I think the worst thing about it is it's quite embarrassing actually, because we were second best from the first minute, and I think it was whatever could go wrong went wrong today.
Well, certainly not a result many of us were expecting. Not that long ago, it looked like Robbie Earnshaw. His days were numbered at the City Ground, but he looks like a player reborn.
Well, I mean, when you look at it, they've got quite a few forwards there, you know, in good nick. But he's been complaining of late. He hasn't been getting enough games. He's been a little bit peripheral. But no, he certainly made his mark today, didn't he? These goals are different, but good in their own way. This is a lovely finish. I know he gets a little bit of luck there, but how many times have we seen forward snatch at those chances and hit the keeper? And then this is a very different goal. Wayne Brown tries to show him on his right. He faints, shimmies, comes inside, and it's a super little finish. They're goal scorers' finishes.
Yeah, certainly are. Amazingly, he's now scored a hat-trick in every league of English football, and the League Cup and the FA Cup.
That is quite a statistic.
That is some achievement.
Fantastic achievement, absolutely.
OK, now to the leaders, Newcastle, then, who'd won their last 5 games, but victory against Watford today would have made it 6 in a row for the first time since Kevin Keegan was in charge back in 1996.
The last time these two sides met was back in 2007, when both were in the top flight. Newcastle looked the more likely to return after their impressive start to the season, but they started this game looking anything but the league leaders. A simple through ball from Henry Lansbury caused confusion in the heart of the Newcastle defence, but Danny Graham couldn't quite capitalise on the mistake, Stephen Taylor mopping up on the line. Newcastle found their feet after 20 minutes, Craig Cathcart asking a bit too much of his keeper. Marlon Harewood pounced, Peter Löwenkrantz finished. But Newcastle aren't known for making life easy for themselves. Kevin Nolan had already been booked when this rash tackle from behind produced a second yellow card from referee Jonathan Moss. As Watford pushed for an equaliser, Newcastle sealed the win in spectacular fashion. Watch closely. How about this for a piece of skill and finish from Fabrice Poncrat? A great way to open your account in English football in what was only his second appearance for Chris Hughton's side. Victory for Newcastle was their 6th in a row, the longest winning sequence by any club this season so far. West Brom were looking for their 5th successive win as they headed to Pride Park to face Derby. but the league's leading scorers were made to battle in what turned out to be a feisty affair. It all started with Graham Doran's reaction to a Robbie Savage challenge, the midfielder perhaps lucky to escape with just a yellow card for what looked like a blatant kick on the former Welsh international. Suitably ruffled, the Baggies nearly conceded the opening goal, Scott Carson showing why he was once an England keeper. But then the breakthrough. Paul Dickov has proved a shrewd loan signing by Nigel Clough. A huge deflection made it 1-0 Derby and gave the 37-year-old his second of the campaign. But there was controversy to follow as West Brom drew level with a goal which could arguably be described as doing a Thierry Henry. The Derby defenders convinced Simon Cox had handled the ball as he bundled it over the line, but their protests fell on deaf ears. And then more drama. West Brom, so devastating on the counter-attack this season, broke with Felipe Teixeira and his clever through ball was expertly dispatched by Graham Dorans to give the Baggies their 17th goal in five games and what looked like all 3 points. But almost straight from the restart, Derby capitalised on some slack Albion defending. Lee Hendry setting up DJ Campbell for his first goal since arriving on loan from Leicester. That 95th minute strike securing a deserved share of the points for the Rams. This stadium could have been hosting Premier League games if it hadn't been for the 6-0 defeat at Preston last season, which ultimately cost Cardiff a playoff place. But it wasn't just about revenge. It was about keeping themselves in the promotion hunt after three straight defeats. David Marshall's acrobatics denying John Parkin to keep the Bluebirds' sheet clean. Shortly after the break, another chance for Parkin, the keeper this time nowhere near it, but defender Kevin McNaughton ideally placed. In difficult conditions, a moment of magic would have to settle things, and it duly came from Chris Burke. Cardiff back in the top six, Preston winless in six. These are good times at Blackpool. The Seasiders have made their best start to a season in 14 years and were protecting an unbeaten home record as they hosted Barnsley at Bloomfield Road. The Tykes were still feeling the injustice of the home park washout last weekend and might have had reason to feel more aggrieved as Ryan Shotton was penalised for what looked like a harsh penalty decision. Charlie Adam took the responsibility from the spot as the Seasiders looked on course for their seventh home win of the season. But with 5 minutes to go, Barnsley's luck changed. Against the run of play, defender Bob Hassel headed home substitute Ian Hume's corner for his first of the season to set up a nervy finish. And with 2 minutes remaining, Barnsley were awarded a penalty of their own. Alex Baptiste, the player adjudged to have handled. Andy Gray stepped up to end his scoring drought with the fourth of his campaign. With no chance of this game being abandoned, Barnsley became the first team this season to leave Bloomfield Road with all 3 points.
That is quite an amazing result for Barnsley and Mark Robbins, isn't it? I mean, Bloomfield Road, as David said there, has been a fortress for Blackpool.
Well, that's the only unbeaten record apart from Newcastle in that division, and Barnsley have broken it. They've had a fantastic run under Mark Robbins. When you think about the position they were in when he took over, you know, if they'd managed to... if that game had stayed fit to play last week and they'd seen that out, they would undoubtedly have won it. They would then be 2 points off of a playoff spot. I mean, that is quite incredible.
You mentioned the unbeaten record now belongs to Newcastle at home after Bloomfield Road's gone for Blackpool. And a fantastic second goal for Newcastle. Fabrice Pongrat,
yes.
A Frenchman. We might not know much about him, but what do you know?
Well, he's 29. He's a midfielder, signed from PSG. He came on and replaced Guthrie in the 71st minute in this game. And, I mean, that's not great defending, you've got to say, but what you can say is, I mean, that looks like his stronger foot, his right one, as he's turned, and he's hit it with his supposedly weaker foot. And, that's some pace on the ball. It was a super goal, and to be fair, they needed that because it just about killed him off.
They beat Watford, of course.
Yeah.
How worried should they be about their current financial problems? They've got to find £5.5 million after Jimmy Russo's given £1 million, five and a half more to see them through to the end of the season.
Yeah, I mean, this isn't something that's crept up on them. I mean, their financial woes have been, have been known about for a while now. I mean, it's probably been the last 18 months that we know that Watford have been, you know, sailing pretty close to the wind, and the way that they've had to run the club, that's what they've had to do. So, Undoubtedly, you'd like to think they'll be able to find that, but it's an awful lot of money, isn't it?
Also highlights the need for Newcastle to get back to the top flight as soon as possible, of course. Well, it was defeat to the Magpies last week that ended Swansea's 11-match unbeaten run. So would Paulo Sousa get the reaction he was looking for when his Swans travelled to bottom club Peterborough?
The Posh were looking for a first win under Mark Cooper at the fourth time of asking when they hosted Swansea. After a goalless first half, Peterborough finally made the breakthrough thanks to Chris Whelpdale. His second goal of the season, the technique spot on. Lee Trundle hasn't quite made the impact at Swansea that he did in his first spell at the club. He's been mostly used as a sub and came on late in the game to prove he's still got some of the old magic. That, on 84 minutes, the type of goal that made Trundle a modern-day Swansea legend. It was his third goal since coming back to the club in August, but a minute into injury time, he was at it again. 2-1 now, and there was still time for one late twist. 4 minutes had already been played over the regulation 90 when Craig McHale-Smith broke through for the home team. The finest of cutbacks, read perfectly by Aaron McLean, who steamed through to score the dramatic equaliser for Peterborough. 2-2. Roy Keane's Ipswich travelled to Bristol City on the back of a seven-game unbeaten run. Not a bad way to respond after such a woeful start to the season. Having seen striker Danny Haynes leave the club for Ashton Gate in the summer, it was perhaps inevitable that he would give his former boss a few nervy moments. Surely the Ipswich defenders knew him well enough not to leave him completely unmarked. Luckily for them, he couldn't make the most. The Tractor boys survived and extend their unbeaten run. Brendan Rodgers arrived at Hillsborough hoping to inflict more pain on Sheffield Wednesday, who'd made their worst start to a league campaign in 7 years, and heaped the pressure on his opposite number, Brian Laws. But it took Reading until the second half to get going here. Two Watford old boys combining, JB McEnough with the cross, Grigor Zrazjak taking his tally to 5 for the season so far. Wednesday had scored just one goal in their last 3 games, and their luck in front of goal wasn't improving against the Royals, Luke Varney's acrobatic effort deserving more. And if you thought that was stylish, so was this passing move, but with a different outcome. Wednesday's tired legs just couldn't keep up. McEnough again the provider from the byline for Khalifa Cisse to seal a much-needed away victory for the Royals, and with it their first clean sheet in 13 games. The boos rang out for Wednesday after a fourth consecutive home defeat.
Of course we're all knocked. But, hey, the only people that are going to turn around is ourselves, and we've got to stand up and be counted.
No wonder Plymouth fans were smiling. Last weekend, their game against Barnsley was abandoned, saving them from a fifth home defeat of the season. There were brighter skies over home park as Kevin Blackwell's resurgent Sheffield United arrived on the back of 2 successive wins. They started to exert their influence in the second half, Plymouth almost paying the price for not clearing the ball, Nick Montgomery so close to putting the Blades in front. With 16 goals, the Pilgrims are the lowest scorers in the Championship. Number 17 from Carl Fletcher would have been one to savour. Not to be, as again the woodwork came to the keeper's rescue. As time wore on, the weather worsened, the Plymouth defence under real pressure, and with 2 minutes left, they cracked. James Harper's 25-yard strike evading everyone for his third goal since arriving from Reading on loan. This time the rain couldn't bail out Paul Sturrock's side. For United, it's a third successive win for the first time this season. It's been a difficult week at Crystal Palace, where financial problems have led to the late payment of wages for the players. It didn't get any better when they played Doncaster at Selhurst Park. After some nice build-up play down the left, Neil Dans could have given the home side the lead. Instead, he gave himself the chance to appear on a bloopers DVD. Palace fans, don't worry, we won't taunt you with a slow-motion replay. Championship Player of the Month Darren Ambrose was looking to break a club record by scoring for an 8th consecutive match, and he really should have done here, Gareth Roberts making the block. And as so often happens, if you don't take your chances, your opponents will. James Chambers doing the hard work. Billy Sharp just doesn't miss those. That's 5 goals in 5 games for the on-loan striker, Donny One Up. Palace had gone 6 games without defeat going into this one, but they went further behind just after the hour. The home defence just not tight enough as Martin Woods put Rovers in complete control. Palace boss Neil Warnock says that Julian Speroni is the best keeper in the Championship, but with defending like this, there was little the Argentine stopper could do to prevent Donny's third from James Hayter. A first away win in the league, and an impressive one at that.
Not a bad way at all to get your first away league win of the season. Two goals in particular from Donny there showed us what they're all about.
Absolutely.
In the Shawn.
Yeah, this is Doncaster in a nutshell, isn't it? I mean, pass, you know, nothing's rushed, nothing's hurried. You know, if we're going to do it, we're going to do it with quality. It's not going to go in the box unless we can do that with some sort of end product. And you know, they work the ball wide. They've had the ball, it's 5 passes so far. Great little bit of play, and as you can see, I mean, there isn't a Crystal Palace player that really gets it near any of those Donny players in that move. And, well, a little bit of luck here, but goes wide again. Now, this ball could go in there, it doesn't, because he's not comfortable putting in. So pass, they wait for the opportunity, and a super finish as well. And as I say, that's the way that Sean O'Driscoll likes his team to play. Ever since he was at Bournemouth, that's how they played. This is how Doncaster play. And it must be nice, you know, every Saturday to turn up at home and watch that sort of quality of football.
We saw a rather nervous and fairly downbeat-looking Brian Laws after Sheffield Wednesday lost at home to Reading. That's 4 defeats in a row at home. Hillsborough natives there are getting restless, aren't they?
Yep, they are, particularly today. And I think the chairman has said, you know, in no uncertain terms, that results have to change and change quickly, you know, or, you know, the manager is going to be under pressure, and that's obviously what's happening.
Right, OK, let's hear from Lizzie then for the first time this evening in terms of your emails and texts. Lizzie.
Manish, I think we've had more texts and emails tonight than we've ever had in the whole history of the show, so thanks very much, everyone, for sending them in. I've got to start with Middlesbrough, because I was actually at that game today. And first of all, a big relief, I guess, for the wife of the Borough fan who texted me a couple of weeks ago to say he wasn't washing until they won. Well, they won today, so I bet she's a happy lady. Alex says, I'm really impressed with Dave Kitson this season. Definitely a key player. Let's hope he stays. Niall says, Strachan and Kitson are great ginger dream team, bring on 6 points next week. But Z Young, who's travelled all the way from China to Loftus Road today, that must be the farthest flung fan, says QPR's finishing was so poor today, I thought the fans in the upper stand behind the goal must have been injured by some of their shots. Julian says, I never thought I'd say this, but the ex-Leicester, Savage and Dickhoff were both outstanding for Derby today. By far the best team performance of the season. Dan says, I think Bristol City should have won today. All we need is confidence and we'll start winning again. As always, we've had lots of Newcastle fans get in touch. Darren says, Steve Harper should be England's number one for the World Cup. Got a question for you here, Steve, from Jonathan. He says, if Newcastle United do get promoted straight away at the end of the season, how do you think, if they had the same team, they'd get on in the Premier League?
I think they just about survive. It would depend a lot on the goal threat up front. But, they're well organised. They're difficult to play against. And a side that are doing that well in the Championship, they're probably a better team now than they possibly might have been in the Premiership.
OK, well, let's go back to Cardiff now. Claire says, glad November's out of the way. Cardiff always rubbish in November. Well done, the boys, getting back to their winning ways. A lot of you have reminded me about what Neil Warnock said last week and saying, do they think that he'd be getting in touch today, saying to me to put more Palace fans on? Well, probably the answer is no. Jake says, up the posh, who needs Darren? Now we just need to get off the bottom. As you'd expect, lots of Forest fans. Very quick question to you, Steve, though. This is to do with Cardiff, actually. He says, Dave wants to know, what happened to Chopra? He looks like a lost man and off the pace. Do you think it's best to keep starting a striker who's in poor form, Steve?
He's a very, very good player at that level, Chopra. He's always going to be a threat. And sometimes, you know, the manager will know Chopra better than anybody else. Sometimes it's you've got to keep faith in somebody and they'll come through that, and undoubtedly he will.
I know injuries and suspensions certainly haven't helped Cardiff's cause thus far. OK, into League One now, where Leeds United haven't lost at home for 20 league games, a record that almost stretches back a year. But the leaders faced a Huddersfield side who scored more goals than anyone else. Nearly 38,000 fans were at Elland Road to see this Yorkshire derby, but we managed to squeeze in our own Mark Clemmit.
Just 16 miles separates these two local rivals, whose rivalry extends to not being able to agree about their rivalry, if that makes sense.
What Huddersfield done for the last, you know, looking at 100 years, to be honest. I mean, I think last time they won the league was 1923 or something like that.
Well, this is the only game that matters for you, isn't it? This is the cup final for Huddersfield.
Oh, is it? Oh, yeah, that's from a team that thinks Man United are still the rivals, say they're champions of Europe, they've never been champions of Europe. It's a cup final for them.
Huddersfield have actually won the last three encounters between the two. They start the day in fifth. Leeds are 10 points clear of the playoffs. They won their last five consecutive league games. It is starting to look like their season.
Can't ask for much more, really. We're top of the table. We're there to be shot at. But we still know we've got a lot of work to be done, and teams are looking, starting today, trying to beat us and catch us. We're trying to pull away from people over the next few weeks, but we've got to keep our feet well and truly on the ground, and hopefully we get to where we want to get to.
You're just coming up to the first anniversary. I mean, are you absolutely loving it?
Oh, I love it. Wanted to be a manager. I thought I was ready for it. I was looking forward to becoming a manager, but since I've been one, it's been even better than I expected. When you don't win or you lose a game, it's very, very difficult. You cannot wait for the next one, but when you win, there's no better feeling.
Well, of course, no trip to Elland Road would be complete without talking to Leeds' number one fans, the Kaiser Chiefs. I predict a riot. Local derby, 12:15 kick-off.
You just can't get the producers these days.
Well, you pick your moments, have a little sort of sabbatical. Are you?
Yeah.
Yeah, just sort of resting a little bit at
yeah.
the moment.
Yeah, that's how it's going, yeah.
So well.
Team goes up, we take a break. That's sort of how it works in Leeds. You can only have one thing going well at the same time.
No.
Look at Leeds, the way that Leeds went down in 2004, 2005, we went up. They went down, we went up. That's how it works.
Oh, but you don't want to reverse the fortunes and things now.
No, we're just levelling it out now.
No, it doesn't count in the Championship. Once you get to the Championship, it's all fine.
Yeah. Are you taking that for granted now that you're going to get to the Championship?
Yes.
Yeah, you are.
We're miles ahead.
Well, you need your backsides kicking if you don't, are you, with this kind of league?
No, hopefully we can keep up the good form and keep going and get up there. I think we deserve to this time.
Both these Yorkshire rivals could be championship bound if their scoring form is anything to go by, and a crowd of 36,000 wouldn't be out of place in the Premier League. Home supporters were in full voice after just 2 minutes. A mistake from Huddersfield keeper Alex Smithies allowed Robert Snodgrass to put Leeds in front, the Scotsman's fifth of the season. But Huddersfield are the division's leading scorers, 41 going into this one, and always look capable of adding to that tally. Jordan Rhodes here hitting the post. The quality of the Elland Road woodwork was soon being tested at the other end in a pulsating first half. Snodgrass looking to double his personal tally with an audacious lob. By his standards, Rhodes is suffering something of a goal drought. The former Ipswich man hadn't scored in his last five and must have thought six was looming as Kasper Ankergren spread himself well. But 3 minutes into the second half, the tenacious Terriers got the leveller their pressure deserved. Lee Novak getting the decisive final touch to Peter Clark's shot for his seventh goal of the season. No League One team has come away from Elland Road with all 3 points, but Huddersfield clearly weren't intimidated. An athletic overhead kick from Anthony Kay brought the best out of Ankergren once more. And how quickly things can change in a football match. Ankergren turned defence into attack with a long ball forward in search of Jermaine Beckford. The prolific striker came off second best in a brave challenge with Smithies, but the ball fell kindly for substitute Max Gradle and Leeds were back in front. But for only 12 minutes, Rhodes eventually got the goal his efforts deserved, his 14th of the season securing a well-earned point for Huddersfield. And it could have been all three had Anthony Pilkington's free kick been a millimetre lower. Both these teams could well be in the promotion shake-up.
Got to give credit to both teams, both trying to win the game in the correct manner. A few tackles flying in, plenty of chances and opportunities. Over the course of the game, probably a fair result.
I think you've seen a derby game where sometimes derby games turn into a little bit of a stalemate in terms of it just turns into a bit of a war, but I think you've seen there from both sides a lot of quality.
Well, that's Leeds unbeaten run now to 6 games. What about Huddersfield then, Steve? 43 goals in 20 games. It's quite staggering. Is it more than a coincidence Lee Clark's style of play, similar to his old bosses, Kevin Keegan?
Well, it's similar in the way that they're free scoring, but they also concede. I mean, it's typical, isn't it? I mean, they're probably the only side that would play the bottom of the league 1 week and draw three off in the midweek, and then play the top of the league
away from home and draw two. I mean, they are certainly a goal-scoring side going forward. They've also got good players at the back. I mean, Nathan Clark, Peter Clark, Smithy's the goalkeeper.
So, very highly rated.
Yeah. I mean, there's certainly an emphasis on scoring goals and going forward at that club, isn't there? Which is great to see, isn't it?
Yeah, it's terrific. Of course it is. Well, with Leeds kicking off early, that meant Charlton knew they had to win to close the gap on the leaders. Phil Parkinson's men are one of three sides still unbeaten at home in League One. So a tough proposition then for a Southend side who'd lost their last five away games in all competitions.
Charlton had good reason to be optimistic against a Southend side who hadn't even scored in four of their last five games. But Steve Tilson's team did create chances at the Valley. Frank Musa fired a warning that they shouldn't be underestimated. It was far from a vintage Charlton performance, but they clinched victory when Lloyd Sam picked out Dion Burton for his fourth goal in five appearances. After that, the home side dug in and did just enough.
We've had some exciting games here over the last few weeks, 5-1 and 4-2, and today was a different type of game, and we had to just grind out a result, and you know, we showed we've got the capabilities to do that.
Colchester's home form has been impressive all season. Leeds are the only team to win here, and that was back in August. Just one goal was good enough to take all 3 points from Bristol Rovers. Kevin Lisby shooting through a crowd of visiting legs to take his goal tally for the season into double figures. Rovers haven't managed a single point on their travel since late September and never looked likely to here. Indeed, Lisby nearly added a second for the home side, whose decent form under manager Aidy Boothroyd shows no sign of letting up.
I think that's as good a performance as we've had this year. You know, we've played football. We did the right things at the right time. We turned them around when the space was in behind them, and I thought we played some terrific stuff in their half as well.
When you haven't won for five league games, the last place to pitch up is Carrow Road. Norwich were top of the League One form table after six wins from seven, and Grant Holt soon showed Oldham why. His 19th of the season, against a club whose entire squad had only managed 16 goals between them. Another one of the Canaries' star performers, Wes Houlihan, went close to increasing the advantage. Heading's not generally his forte, but with the ball at his feet, the Irish midfielder's a real handful. His ferocious drive meant there was no way back for Oldham, who've now gone 4.5 hours without scoring. Keegan Parker had a great opportunity to at least break that sequence, but Fraser Forster refused to be beaten on another satisfying afternoon for the home side.
I think the way certain teams come here and sit and try and defend and try and matches, and we have to be patient to try and break them down, but I thought some of the football we played was really good.
It was Armed Forces Day at Stadium MK. The Dons delighted to play their part in raising funds for the Help for Heroes campaign. Yeovil had scored only 5 goals on the road all season, but Milton Keynes were caught with their guard down as Dean Bowditch took advantage of some generous defending to claim the opening goal after just 27 seconds. The Dons have been wobbling in recent weeks, 4 league defeats in a row coming into this one. Thank goodness then for the goals of Sam Baldock, who levelled 3 minutes later with his 7th in as many games. Back came the Glovers, Gavin Tomlin making inroads deep into Milton Keynes' territory and eventually laying the ball off for Swansea loanee Sean McDonald to score his first of the season. But the Dons ended their losing streak thanks to a second-half penalty. Terrell Forbes assessed for bringing down Aaron Wilbraham, and spot-kick specialist Peter Leaven emphatically smashing home his 3rd penalty of the season and celebrating with an appropriate and respectful salute.
The forces are certainly with Swindon recently. 3 league wins in a row have put them in contention for a playoff place. And Orient's Jamie Jones had to be on his toes to keep Billy Painter from opening the scoring. Not that it was one-way traffic. At the other end, Sean Thornton found David Lucas equally sharp. The second time, he really should have had no chance. After the break, the deadlock didn't last for long. 6 minutes in, Alan Sheehan was pulled back by Stephen Purchase. This time, Painter got the better of Jones, though only just. Thornton wasn't finished either. Midway through the second half, his free kick deceived Lucas, and Leighton Orient were level. But the Londoners' prospects of a first away win for more than 2 months plummeted once Charlie Austin restored Swindon's lead with his third goal in as many league games. The striker, who managed 46 in 46 matches for non-league Poole Town last season, is looking like an inspired signing. With 5 minutes to go, he displayed his predatory instincts again. The former Reading trainee appears to be relishing his second crack at league football, but for Tamaka Makandawiri's mistimed tackle, he might well have gone on to complete a hat-trick, a fact not lost on the ref, who showed the Orient man a straight red. Still time for Thornton to strike a game from distance, but not enough to prevent Orient's fourth successive away defeat, while Swindon continue their charge up the table.
Yeah, they're definitely heading in the right direction, Swindon Town, and I know they're all getting very excited in Wiltshire about this new fella, Charlie Austin, 20 years of old from non-league football. The boy can finish, can't he?
He can. I mean, I'm going to big myself up, but it is someone that I could almost relate to, because this sort of positioning, this sort of anticipation, it's not something that you can teach. It's something that, you know, you're given. And to be in the right place at the right time is an art in itself. And quite clearly, he's got that attribute. I mean, he's both the position of where he is. You know, it's all about that second phase. And he's obviously well aware of what can happen when the ball goes in the box.
I know their chairman is trying to temper expectations, saying don't expect too much too soon.
Yeah, I mean, there will always be comparisons with Simon Cox, who's just left, because he was an out-and-out goal scorer. But, I mean, things can change very quickly for youngsters. You know, you've got to give him time to get a base and learn the game and get some experience. But it's a great start, isn't it?
OK, well, now to Adams Park, then. That hosted the day's big game at the bottom. Wickham took on Stockport, both sides managing just 3 wins apiece so far this season.
It's only December, but this was an early relegation six-pointer at Adams Park. Visitors Stockport came in on the back of a six-match losing streak, although you wouldn't have known it from the quality of Carl Baker's opener on 64 minutes. Baker's 12th of the season might be his best yet. The chairboys are improving under the stewardship of Gary Waddock and were level 10 minutes later. Chris Westwood heading home Scott Davis's corner, and the two of them celebrating with something they must have prepared earlier. Reading loanee Davis then scored what might prove to be a priceless winner 7 minutes from time, and Lady Luck had a hand in this one. A deflection left county keeper Fon Williams flailing helplessly. 3 wins out of 4 for Wickham, who've suddenly found some self-belief.
The revival appears to be on for Tranmere Rovers, who've now picked up 7 points from 9. There was a scare or two against Brentford, John Bostock's free kick not too far wide, but it was John Welsh's quick thinking with a dead ball that really made the difference. A cute pass, and Craig Curran made it count, his second goal of the week after that notable draw at Huddersfield. If it wasn't for the bravery of Bees keeper Wojciech Szczesny, Tranmere would have liked the look of the final score even more, but for now, they'll be happy just to be winning.
Chillingham's home form is keeping them out of trouble. They haven't lost at Priestfield since August, but couldn't find a way past a resolute Carlisle. Simeon Jackson came closest, his shot cleared off the line by Ian Hart. Carlisle had won 3 in a row, and it would have been 4 had Hart's late free kick not been repelled by Simon Royce. This one finished goalless.
With 2 goalkeepers unavailable, Brighton gave trialist Peter Brezovan a short-term deal, and Gus Poyet plunged a player he knew from his Swindon days straight into the breach. The check-up ended Stuart Fleetwood early in the second half and seemed set for an unenjoyable debut. But Brezovan redeemed himself to thwart Marcus Stewart. And when Adam Stansfield was set free, the Giants stopper stood firm to frustrate the home side again. Poyet and his counterpart Paul Tisdale are on the same UEFA Pro licence course, so this was a good test of their friendship as Brighton skipper Andrew Croft's pinch victory deep into stoppage time.
Pools United were formed in 1908 and were founder members of Division 3 North in 1921.
During the First World War, a German Zeppelin on a bombing mission over Teesside jettisoned its load on their Victoria Road ground, destroying the main stand. In the late 1920s, when his players complained about having to train in severe wintry conditions, manager Bill Norman stripped naked and rolled across the pitch in the snow. Don't even think about it. The Vic's most memorable game, 1957's FA Cup third round tie with Manchester United. 3-1 down, Pools pulled it back to 3-3 before the Busby Babes scored a late, late winner. Matt Busby himself described it as the most exciting game he'd ever seen. In 1965, the board appointed Sunderland youth team coach Brian Clough as their manager after their first choice couldn't agree terms. During his 2 years at Hartlepool, Clough gave another future double European Cup winner John McGovern his career debut. Recognise those mutton chop sideburns? Neil Warnock won the club's Player of the Year award in 1972, and Phil Brown was PFA union representative a decade later, at one stage threatening a player's strike after the club's bank account was frozen and wages had gone unpaid. Air guitars at the ready? Hartlepool born Iron Maiden guitarist Yannick Gers is said to be a fan. And in 1992, Hartlepool went 13 games, 1,227 minutes, without scoring a goal. The longest blank run in English football history.
Hartlepool ended a sequence of three defeats despite an early wobble against a Millwall side who hadn't lost away since September. Steve Morrison charged down an attempted clearance from Scott Flinders. It came back off the bar, much to the relief of a red-faced goalkeeper. The home side's nerves were settled after that scare, and when Millwall failed to clear their lines after 12 minutes, they were cruelly punished by the accuracy of Peter Hartley. The Lions leaked three inside the first half hour as they dithered in defence. Adam Boyd was next to profit, squeezing in his seventh of the season from a tight angle. And when Icelandic import Armand Bjornsson headed home number three, it was all over. Bjornsson is one of a handful of people who can just about look Peter Crouch in the eye. His second goal in as many games had Millwall well and truly cut down to size.
Going into the weekend, Leeds were the only side to have overturned Walsall on their own patch. And Darren Byfield wasn't far from getting the Saddlers off to a superb start against Southampton. But Alan Pardew's team are really motoring themselves, chasing a fourth win on the spin. And after missing the last two matches, David Connolly marked his return in style. The Irishman's sixth of the season, and he was instrumental too as Saints stretched the advantage. Connolly's shot deflected into the path of Dean Hammond. Now Walsall were really in trouble against a side who'd avoided defeat in their previous nine away trips. Once Connolly played in Ricky Lambert after the break, the outcome was never in doubt. 9 goals in the last 8 league appearances for Lambert, 17 for the season. Walsall responded quickly, Troy Deeney setting up Byfield to prod home his 100th career goal, but the Saints went marching on.
I'm going really well under Alan Pardew, but the result of that roundup, I suppose, has to be Hartlepool's home win against Millwall. Considering when you've had two of your forwards ruled out for the next 2 or 3 months, In they come with 3 goals. I mean, I think Chris Turner said it's like Man U being without Rooney and Berbatov.
Yeah, I think it's, what was it, Brown and Behan out. Yeah. But they got the job done very, very early, 3-0 up after half an hour. And that's an excellent result. And Millwall have got a problem. They haven't kept a clean sheet for 9 games.
Worrying.
So, yes, you'll want to... Kenny Jackett will want to sort that out very, very quickly.
It's gone very quiet on the management situation at Prenton Park in terms of Tranmere. A valuable win for Les Parry, who's in charge. Obviously, their old physio. His third win... Does he stand a chance of getting the job full-time?
I think so. I mean, 3 wins in 9. I think there's a draw on top of that as well. And, you know, if you're working on that sort of ratio and that sort of average, you would stay up. So, no doubt, there's been some sort of turnaround at that club, and that's why things are quiet.
Looking at Wickham's winner against Stockport, that was a valuable goal for Wickham.
It was, yeah. Scott Davis, I watched him last year. He was on loan at Aldershot, actually, from Reading. And you need that little bit of luck, and it takes a huge deflection, but... That could be a big result for them come the end of the season. And you do think that things are on the turn now.
It was a slow start for Gary Waddick, wasn't it? But it's coming together slowly for them. Right, let's hear from Lizzie now. Emails and texts from League One fans. Lizzie.
Yeah, first of all, just going to quickly talk about the Championship. Forest fans, no, it's not a conspiracy. I just ran out of time talking about the Championship. I'm very sorry. Leeds fans, we had lots of you getting in touch as well. But I've got to say, Jason, sending your email in capitals does not mean I'm going to read it out, all right? Andrew says the Yorkshire Derby was a fantastic advert for League One football. It was fast, furious and skillful. But Roger says Leeds may win the league, but we won't be far behind. Up the Terriers. Swindon fans, we had lots of you getting in touch to tell me how great Charlie Austin is. Jamie says, well done, Danny Wilson, for bringing Charlie Austin from non-league. He has great potential. But Ali says Swindon's Alan Sheehan could give Tom Daly a run for his money. Jack says, I only just got to see the first Yeovil goal as I walked into the stadium. It has to be one of the quickest goals this season in all of English football so far. Well, you'd think so, but keep watching because there's an even faster one coming up in League Two. By the way, the record in English football is 4 seconds. Karen has a message for Exeter boss Paul Tisdale, if you're watching, Paul. You say we're playing well, but we're struggling up front. We need someone to score goals. So watch this space in January. Ash says, excellent point for the Cumbrians, talking about Carlisle, of course, today against a good team. But John says, I'm a big Gillingham fan and I'm becoming increasingly frustrated with their away form. Supporting Gillingham away has become as stressful as an extra day at work. Oh dear, that's not much fun on a Saturday. Susie, Wickham fans, says, a few weeks ago we looked dead and buried, but now we're staying up. And I've just got a question for Steve. This is all to do with Stockport County, who, of course, are in administration. They want to know, Steve, how do you keep young players motivated? Because, of course, they've got a lot of young players there at Stockport County.
You shouldn't need to keep young players motivated. It's the older lads that would be worried if they weren't getting paid. I mean, young players should just be there for the fun of it at this stage, because it's not just about money for young players. That should be just about getting a foothold in the game.
Yeah, exuberance of youth should carry you through more than anything.
Absolutely.
All right, now, Rochdale have enjoyed the last few days as the new leaders of League Two, and if they were to end the day top, they needed to notch up a fourth straight win. They're up against a Macclesfield side who hadn't won in 5 league games.
Rochdale continue to blaze a trail at the top of the table as Keith Hill's side made it 4 wins in a row with this routine victory. Dale took the lead on the half hour. Chris O'Grady out-muscled Carl Tremarco and teed up on lone Hull midfielder Will Atkinson to grab his first for the club with a tap-in. The home side doubled their lead just 3 minutes later when right-back Scott Wiseman also broke his Dale goal duck as the luckless Tremarco's attempted clearance fell perfectly into his path. Macclesfield were always struggling to get back into things, and the task became mission impossible in the 69th minute when Sean Brisley brought down the lively O'Grady as he charged through on goal, resulting in the inevitable red card. With the points secured, Dale cruised through the remainder of the match, adding a third in stoppage time. Jason Taylor, on loan from Rotherham, became the third player to open his account for the club when he turned in Atkinson's cross after a superb build-up. On this form, Dale are going to be up amongst the front runners for some time to come.
A deluge at Dean Court was never likely to make for a great game, and high-flying Bournemouth found it difficult to see off Shrewsbury. Liam Feeney's impressive run rather spoiled by a weak finish. In the end, the Shrews did the job for their hosts. 5 minutes from time, when it seemed a goalless draw was on the cards, Graham Coughlin got his angles dreadfully wrong to keep the Cherries in the thick of the promotion chase. Their first home win since October.
Rotherham boss Ronnie Moore was handed the League Two Manager of the Month award before the game, and inevitably that proved to be a bad omen as the Millers struggled to dispose of Burton Albion on a pudding of a pitch at the Don Valley Stadium. The visitors literally handed Rotherham the chance to take the lead, Paul Bertian thrusting an arm skyward, possibly not realising that the referee was right in front of him. Adam Lafondre is scoring for fun at the moment, so Rotherham were in front 6 minutes before the half. When you're in the kind of form Lafondre's enjoying, you think you'll score from anywhere, any time. And the former Rochdale man very nearly did it again. His superb lob would have been a goal of the month candidate. Adam Rundle could have done more with the follow-up. But a second wasn't long in coming. On 63 minutes, Burton's Darren Stride decided to be generous, and that was Lafondre's 17th goal in all competitions this season. Burton on their knees. The Brewers seem to be heading for their 5th defeat in 6 matches, but things look very different just 2 minutes later. Good work down the right from Greg Pearson. Steve Cabba got stuck in the mud, but Aaron Webster was on hand to reduce the deficit with a crisp finish. Things were to get even worse for the home side when Nick Fenton got it all wrong. His crude lunge on goalscorer Webster earned a straight red. Ronnie Moore described the challenge as stupid. Rotherham down to 10 men with 18 minutes still to play, and Albion made their man advantage count. With just 5 minutes remaining, Pearson dug the ball out of the swamp to steal a point for the visitors. Rotherham are still unbeaten at home, but that's probably not much consolation.
Grimsby have won just once at home all season, so it seemed a plausible place for Dagenham and Redbridge to get their campaign back on track. But the promotion chasers trailed at half-time. Mickey Featherstone's cross caused confusion in the Daggers' defence, and Michael Coulson kept calm to capitalise. His first goal since signing on loan from Barnsley had the Mariners hopeful of a league win at last. They've waited since mid-September. Peter Sweeney went close to making the lead more comfortable. Grimsby will still be cursing that bad luck, which allowed Dagenham and Redbridge to rescue a draw after the break. It's still four league games without a win for the Essex club, but after Danny Green's cross was flicked over Nick Colgan by John Nurse, they did at least avoid defeat.
Aldershot fans have plenty to jump up and down about these days. Unbeaten in eight, they're now firmly in the promotion picture following this narrow win over Chesterfield. Just one goal and it came midway through the second half. Anthony Charles claiming his second of the season. After a good run, the Spirites are slumping. This is their third loss in a row and they had no luck. David Perkins deserved better. Another 3 points for the Red Hot Shots.
Bury were quickly back on track after suffering their first league defeat in 12 against Morecambe. The Shakers breaking Barnett's resistance on the stroke of half-time after Andy Morrell was clipped by Mark Hughes. Daniel Nardiello never looked like squandering the opportunity, his third goal in five games since joining on loan from Barnsley. Bury sealed the points late on when Ismail Yakubu sold his keeper short and David Worrell made the most of the mistake. To wrap up Barnett's miserable trip, and an especially sour day for Hughes, the midfielder was sent off for pulling back Richie Baker in the final minute. More than enough for a second booking.
Yeah, good win for Bury. I've got to mention a very interesting little fact from Aldershot, actually, because Kevin Dillon is doing a fantastic job there, isn't he? Unbeaten in six games in the league. But he stopped his defenders from celebrating goals. I mean, a defender scored today, he probably would have celebrated. But if it was a forward, he wants them to keep their focus and stay back. I mean, have you ever heard anything like that?
No, I mean, obviously, I can understand what he means. It's no good wasting energy going forward and then having to get all the way back. But say your defender actually scores.
It's going to be hard not to celebrate,
I suppose. Just run back into position and then start celebrating. Yeah. Might be just a touch overkill, but hey, no one's going to complain all the time.
It's certainly working for him.
They're six unbeaten. So, I mean, he's been OK because he's taken over from Gary Waddock. Gary Waddock left to go to Wickham and the team were going very well. And he's just kept it ticking along nicely. So that's a sign of a good manager.
Rochdale have now won their last four. A lot's been made of how long Rochdale have been in this division.
Yes.
I think they'll be fed up of trying to go through the playoffs after the last 2 years. Well, they'll be looking for the automatic places.
Yeah, and they look primed for it, don't they? I mean, they look in really, really good form. They've got some good players at that point. When you think about it, it was two defenders and a midfielder scored today. You know, the likes of Dagenham and Grady up front for them, you know, they should be OK.
Yeah, interesting. Stuart McCall said that's the best pairing they've faced this season. Well, they don't score today in three goals.
That augurs well, then, doesn't it, for them, if they've got the best two up front.
It sure does. OK, well, it's starting to look very bleak for Darlington. The Quakers had chipped in 13 goals in the last three defeats and face a Bradford City side who struggled to get their season going with just two wins from the last 10 league games.
Bradford City got back to winning ways after a midweek loss to Rochdale and they brushed aside the challenge of Darlington thanks to former hairdresser Steve Williams, a stylish finish on 23 minutes. The league's bottom side have scored only four goals at home all season and rarely look like adding to that wretched tally. With more than half the season still to be played, Darlow looked doomed.
Fresh from thumping Cheltenham midweek, a foul on Scott Rendell gave Torquay a terrific start at Accrington Stanley. Nicky Rowe used the spot kick to get the Devon club dreaming of their first back-to-back victories of the season. But the reality check arrived when Michael Symes went to ground under Lee Mansell's challenge. The referee consistent, another pull of the shirt penalised, and the same result too from the spot. Phil Edwards' goal was the springboard that really had the home team bouncing. Just a minute later, Symes was the catalyst again, bursting down the flank to centre for Andy Proctor. Symes is usually among the goals himself. Going into the match, he'd scored 7 of Accrington's last 9. But in this game, was happy to see some others take the plaudits. Billy Key's hopeful back heel was made to look inspired by an excellent finish from Luke Joyce, his first for the club. And with 20 minutes to go, the home team was well and truly home and dry. Proctor the supplier this time to find Bobby Grant all alone. As Accrington moved further clear of trouble, Torquay remained too close to the bottom for comfort. Though from a very unlikely angle, Chris Zabrowski did at least make the scoreline look a bit more respectable, 8 minutes from the end.
League Two aficionados know not to expect a glut of goals when Lincoln are around. And so it proved once again, as Crewe's Clayton Donaldson was denied by the crossbar in the 14th minute. Lincoln didn't create much themselves, although Eric Lecharge forced a good save from Steve Phillips. No surprise that this one failed to trouble the scoreboard operators.
At Cheltenham, a typical League Two game, according to Northampton manager Ian Sampson, which some of the division's higher placed sides might dispute. Not much finesse about most of the goals. The first put past his own keeper by Ryan Gilligan, though Cheltenham's Barry Howes was widely credited with his 4th of the season. The lead lasted only 45 seconds, the home side's defence equally shambolic and punished by 3 neat touches from Adiakim Femwa. Nicely taken. And there was no dispute about the next contribution from Howes. The veteran striker's instinctive reaction had Cheltenham back in front on the half hour. The Robins were seeking their second victory in 3 league games, having previously gone 10 without a win. But they're hampered by one of League Two's most generous defences, and Akin Femwa took advantage soon after the break to earn Northampton a share of the spoils.
Not so long ago, Morecambe were the division's draw specialists. Now the Shrimps can't stop winning. Victory at Port Vale was their 6th on the spin, and Phil Jevons was in a hurry to set them on their way. This stunning effort is 13th of the season, coming with just 25 seconds on the clock. Jevons is on loan from Huddersfield and looks capable of operating at a higher level. He looks set for a second, only to be thwarted by a fingertip save from Chris Martin in the Vale goal. Morecambe used to leak goals all over the place, but that's changed too. This was their 4th successive clean sheet, although David Artell made sure the keeper Barry Roach was still concentrating. The clincher came 6 minutes before the break, and it was tough on Vale's Doug Loft, whose attempted clearance fell straight into the path of Paul Mullin, and the 35-year-old front man couldn't miss. Roach made another smart save to deny Vale and confirm a 6th win in a row for Morecambe, their best run since joining the Football League.
Hereford have been tough to beat at Edgar Street this season, losing just once. And they must have fancied their chances of inflicting a surprise defeat on Notts County when Casper Schmeichel clattered into Mark Pugh. Schmeichel escaped with just a yellow card, and Hereford's sense of injustice increased as he kept out Ryan Valentine's penalty. To make matters worse for the home side, just past the half hour, Notts County took the lead. Lee Hughes and Craig Westcar caused all sorts of havoc, and the latter applied the decisive touch. 6 minutes into the second half, County were well on course for back-to-back league wins. Mike Edwards on the end of Ben Davis's free kick. Hereford could pose only the occasional threat. Pugh found himself one-on-one with Schmeichel again, only for the keeper to foil him with a clean challenge this time. At the other end, Adam Bartlett earned his corn too. A fine save from Jamie Clapham kept the deficit down to 2.
Yeah, it's 42 goals in 20 games for Notts County, doing fantastically well at the minute. But for Morecambe, I think we have to mention their achievements under Sammy McElroy.
Absolutely.
One win in 14, now they've won six in a row.
Yes.
In Phil Jevons, I mean, they've got a proven goal scorer who's doing the business.
Well, they've got two, actually. Paul Mullen as well, who scored also today. He's from Accrington. He's got an awful lot of goals for them, came out in the non-league. And, yeah, that's a superb finish. That really is a sublime finish there from Phil Jevons. And someone who's, you know, who's been around, but yeah, will guarantee you goals at this level.
I should think they'll try and get him permanently from Huddersfield, don't you think?
Well, I mean, where does that turnaround come from? One win in 14, you win your next six. I mean, that's quite amazing, isn't
it? So where do you think they'll finish? I mean, they finished the last two seasons in 11th.
Look, anything could happen. If you're on that sort of run, you know, and you've got two players, as I said, that you can score you goals, then the belief will start flooding through your side. And, you know, we're not to say where they can finish, but they can certainly get top six if they continue in the same vein.
OK, well, let's hear from Lizzie now. Lizzie, to you.
Hi, Manish. Well, first of all, hello to all the Rochdale fans who Radio 5 earlier called the Susan Boyle of the Football League. I'm not sure if that's a good thing. Tony says, with key players out injured, God help the rest when they return. He wants me to say up the Dale in a northern accent, but I can't do it. But I will say up the Dale. Dunk says, the mighty Imps put in a great performance, talking about Lincoln City, of course, against a good crew side. Please thank the stewards as they were excellent. Gerald, a Notts County fan, says, I'm loving the Swedish revolution there. Kieran, a Hereford fan, says, Hereford shouldn't feel disgraced. They played well today. Nice to hear from so many Accrington Stanley fans after their big win today. Paul says, up the Stanley, but why can't they play like that more often? Callum says, another day, another draw. Will Grimsby ever see 3 points? Angus says, I think Morecambe deserve a mention, as you just said, Manish, after a fantastic six-game winning streak. Louis, a Burton fan, says, I'm starting to get a little bit worried that we've peaked too soon in our first Football League season. Hopefully, we can get a good run together and push for the playoffs. Jack, who's a Shrewsbury fan, says, unlucky to lose today. Typical Shrews, conceding an own goal at the death. And finally, Tom has sent a plea to the Cheltenham players that he wants me to read out for their next away game to Chesterfield. It says, dear Chesterfield players, please give it your all, but make sure you keep it tight at the back and we may get a good result. I will be watching, and there'll be a few more watching too as well there, Cheltenham players. Thanks for all those emails, and I'm really sorry if I didn't read yours out.
OK, great stuff, Lizzie. Thanks as always. Well, let's see what all that means for your team in terms of the league table. Well, let's start with the top of League Two, as always. Rochdale lead the way with 41 points. Could this finally be their year? They lead Bournemouth by just the point. Rotherham stay in third with 36. Notts County up to fourth. Then it's Dagenham and Redbridge. Aldershot and Chesterfield complete the top seven. Well, at the bottom, Darlington's struggles go on. They're stuck on 8 points. Now 11 points from safety, with Grimsby on 15 after their draw on Saturday. In League One, Leeds remain top, but drop points, of course, against Huddersfield. But Charlton are now just 4 points behind, followed by Norwich. Then it's Colchester, Huddersfield and Swindon, who've moved up 4 places to get into the playoff positions. It's been a pretty bad day for Stockport County and their fans. They lost their 7th in a row on Saturday. And to compound their miseries, the 3 teams above them all won. Well, finally, to the Championship, Newcastle's relentless march goes on. 4 points clear of West Brom, who drew, of course, away to Derby. Nottingham Forest leapfrog Leicester City after that handsome victory at the City Ground. And then it's Cardiff and Middlesbrough. Their big win today means that they go up to 6th place. While at the bottom, Peterborough, well, despite drawing, have now got 13 points. Plymouth then on 15, with Ipswich on 17 points. Well, just to let you know that we're back next week at the slightly earlier time of 10 to midnight, and you've got till midday to watch us back via the red button, but you'll have to wait a couple of hours before that becomes available. The website, however, will have all the action, and the whole programme is on the iPlayer 2 all week. Don't forget, Match of the Day 2 is on BBC 2 at 10 o'clock on Sunday night. My thanks, as always, to Steve. Good to see you tonight. Thanks to Lizzie as well. I hope it's been a good weekend for your team. Have a great week. Good night.